Welcome to CivilNet. We have a very special guest joining us today via Skype from New York City, Lola Kundakcian. She is a poet. Lola, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
You know, reading up about you, reading some of your poetry, actually listening to you recite, was quite a revelation. You know, I've heard about you for many years, but to actually get to know you through your poetry was a real privilege. And I want to thank you for that, because today in our contemporary, fast-moving, entertainment-oriented life, oftentimes the written word, especially in Armenian, in Western Armenian, is being lost.
Կյանք, այս մեկը կործարանի մեջ մերավ 25 տարեկանին, ուրիշ մզին որ, երորդ մը գետոյի մեջ նահատակ, գինմը շապատը յոտը օր գսպասարգե, քույրը ուրիշին զավակները գմերցնե, կյանքի հերոսներ, երբ ձեր կյանքին պիտի հանգչիք, ով ձեր զավակները գմերցնե, ով ձեր մահուն գուլա.
So it was a real privilege and honor to read some of your poems. But today I want to start off our conversation because it is the centenary of the Armenian Genocide of 1915, and because you are a contemporary poet, to talk about what this past century has meant for Armenians, for writers. You know, on April 24, 1915, all of the Armenian intellectuals were rounded up and deported, many, the vast majority of them dying. What does it mean for you to be a contemporary Armenian poet living in the diaspora today?
That's a very loaded question. I'll try to answer.
We're going to start with the tough one, and then we'll ease up.
Contemporary poetry is in a fascinating state today in the world because of globalization. We are in contact with everyone. That gives us two opportunities, one for growth, to read everybody's work, and one, an opportunity to teach everybody else about our heritage. So I have the privilege of meeting a lot of contemporary authors at international poetry festivals, exchanging books, chatting with them over breakfast tables, and sharing with them who I am, where I come from, and what my heritage is. And it is an amazing privilege. Of course, that means that I have to be aware of former authors, those who died or those who survived, because luckily we have had a few who made it through the Armenian Genocide, either because they traveled or they happened to be, you know, across the street when the troops came to gather people. So one has to be aware of this inheritance. One has to know their work. One has to read them as much as possible as one builds her own voice, as well as sharing this with other authors from around the world.
Lola, you said it's a privilege. Is it also a burden? Is it a responsibility that you feel upon your shoulders?
No, it would be one if I was paused the question, but I did not know the answer. What does it mean to be an Armenian poet today? Luckily, I do know that. There might be individuals who are not aware, who are uncomfortable because they don't have that information to share with others.
You also are different and unique for me because you are fluent in both Western Armenian and in English, and you write in both languages. And as I said in the beginning, it is a unique role that you have, and Western Armenian, the language itself today, is in danger of dying out. Is there a specific message you have by writing in Armenian, or is that the language in your brain, in your head, in your mind, in your heart?
Well, I moved to New York City when I was 17, and all of my upper level education is in English, solely in English. So I was writing all of my college papers in English, etc. I had to make an extra effort, first of all, to retain my day-to-day conversation. Luckily, I lived with my parents, and they stayed in New York even when I moved out. So I use Armenian, Western Armenian on a day-to-day basis. But when it came down to writing, I had to make an extra effort to go back to the word and, you know, spell checking and all the nitty-gritty that we do to retain information in our brain. I'm extremely privileged that I have certain degree of facility with foreign languages, but at the same time, if you don't make an effort, you lose it. Simple as that. So one has to be aware of that. One has to retain old dictionaries. One has to make an effort.
Right. I want to talk about the Armenia Poetry Project that you curate and something called the Dead Armenian Poets Society. Could you elaborate a little bit what the Dead Armenian Poets Society is?
It used to be a monthly meeting around the time I finished Columbia University, where we would gather in my living room and read the work of dead poets of Armenian heritage. And although I don't meet on a monthly basis anymore, it's a very hip gathering. We have Armenians as well as our non-Armenian friends meeting us and reading in any translation the work of dead Armenian poets. Unfortunately, Zahrad recently joined the group. You know, we couldn't read him for a very long time until he passed away a short while ago. But that's what we do. And then we party. A little wine, a little cheese, and reading poetry. And out of that, and the technology that came up about a dozen years ago, the RSS feeds, I thought about posting a few things online. So I started a blog, and I noticed that, A, it was being picked up by the all the bots, as they call them, web searching tools, right? And also that people were actually visiting those pages, because I've kept statistics. And I was very excited that there are people from all over the world interested in Armenian poetry. So it gave me an incentive to add more and more material. And now we have over 500,000 readership. I mean, this is the effort of one person. Please understand that it's not an organization. I don't have a ton of people volunteering. I have a few people who have read work, because once in a while this voice box gets a cold. And also, people submit suggestions. But I have over 2,200 entries, including some book notices or meetings by the Hamaskayin or Tekeyan Cultural Association in North America saying, we have a literary event, could you please post it? Glad to do that. And also, some audio recordings. There are about 160, I'd say, audio recordings done by myself or a few friends of mine.
Well, it just goes to show you that if you put your mind to it, you can certainly not only move mountains, you can certainly impact and shape opinion and bring something new to an audience that perhaps wouldn't have had the opportunity to read that. You were, I think, the first Armenian poet to take part in the International Poetry Festival that took place in Quebec in the autumn of 2014. What was that like? What did that mean for you?
It was my fourth International Poetry Festival, and regretfully, on all four of them, I was the first. Because I think that these poetry festivals don't have opportunities to read works by Armenian authors because they're not translated into French and Spanish, for example. That's the primary, source of information for them. They also don't have opportunities to meet other authors in reunions, and therefore lack of communication, lack of opportunities for many Armenians. It was an amazing privilege in all four times to represent a country or its diaspora and its civilization, its literature. I'm extremely humbled by these experiences. I've met amazing people, very generous, very open to learning about other societies. We are, in a way, a United Nations of writers. It's a unique, unique way of establishing contacts with the world. And it's an opportunity that we must all seek, naturally, not forcefully. But the way to do it is to participate, to accept invitations, to be ready with translations, to be published online or otherwise. It's a lot of work that needs to be done gradually and naturally, but we have to be ready when the opportunity knocks.
Right, I couldn't agree with you more. Lola, just as a final question, we started off our conversation talking about the 100th anniversary of the Armenian genocide. And nothing is going to end after April 24th. Life will continue. We will continue struggling. We will continue seeking for justice and recognition. But what do you want to see for the next 100 years for the Armenian nation in terms of, you know, in terms of being a writer, in terms of poetry and literature? Where do you want to see the Armenian nation going?
I'd like to see readership and publication go up a few notches. I've never lived in Armenia, but from what I know that book printing is, there are a lot of small presses doing excellent work, but I'd like them to print in the thousands instead of the hundreds, from what I know. I'd like to have people read more books. The majority of people who read the Armenian Poetry Project are in Armenia, and that opens up a lot of questions in my mind. Why are the majority of poetry readers online from Armenia versus the diaspora? I thought my readership would be different, for example. Opportunities are greater, meaning in Armenia, for buying books versus, or borrowing them from libraries versus an individual who happens to be visiting Timbuktu and misses poetry and decides to seek something online. Those are the two things. I'd like to see a continuation of the Armenian, the poetry festival in Armenia. There was one about a year ago, before Mr. Ananyan died. I'd like to see that continued. And I'd like to see more opportunities for exchanges, inviting, for example, a Western poet or two on a regular basis to teach, to read in Armenia, and for Armenian poets to go outside and do the same. Now, there are a few individuals who are invited to colonies, reading retreats, and so forth, but I'd like to see a lot more of that. It is we don't live in a separate globe. We are part of this wonderful land called Earth, and we have to look to think globally.
Oh, well, couldn't agree with you more, thinking globally, being part of the global conversation. Lola Kundakchyan, thank you so much for joining us from New York. Good luck with all of your initiatives, and we hope to meet up with you again soon.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
I'd like to remind our viewers that my guest was poet Lola Kundakchyan from New York City. Stay with CivilNet.